We are here today and gathered in this place to remember and to honor the life of Michael Grosso. And on behalf of his family, especially his daughters, Adeline, Raylan, his parents, Carolyn and Ron, Brother David, Sister Gigi, I want to thank you for coming and being here with them and for them today. A moment and a season like this for them as family is difficult, and your presence and the expression of your care for them just simply by being here and walking with them, certainly remembering them in your thoughts and in your prayers over these past days, has meant a tremendous amount to them. And so again, thank you for being here. On their behalf, as many of you may have seen in the obituary, they would invite you following the service to join them actually directly across the street at Rimini's restaurant, where they'll continue to be with one another and fellowship together, and as many of you as can, they would certainly welcome you to come and to continue to be with them there. We gather not only in the presence of family and friends today, we also gather together in the presence of God's Spirit, who is here among us. And having been Carolyn and Ron's pastor, having that privilege while they were here in Roanoke, and having had Michael in many of the services of worship with them, we can confidently conduct his service today in the context of the Christian faith and hope. And we're reminded of the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, who came upon a scene similar to this. He came upon two sisters that were grieving the recent loss of their brother. And he said to them, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whosoever believes in me, though they be dead, yet shall they live. For whosoever believes in me shall never die." And so while Michael's earthly journey has come to its conclusion, his life has not, but now continues on in the presence of the one who is his creator and his redeemer. Let us pray together. Our Heavenly Father, as we gather in this moment to be with Michael's family, we unite our hearts and our minds in lifting them up to you and praying that you would give to them through your promises and through your presence hope and encouragement and strength, not only in this service and in this day, but in these days and times to come. May they draw upon the resources that they have as family, and may they draw upon the resources that you provide to us in faith. And so as we honor Michael today, may by extension we also honor you as the one who created him, redeemed him, and now have received him into your presence through your love and your grace expressed to us through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so it is in his name that we pray and that we conduct this service. Amen. I want to take a moment and just share a few passages of Scripture that simply remind us of God's promises for us, of the provisions that He makes for us. And from Psalm 139, the psalmist has written, "O Lord, You have searched me and You know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, You know it completely, O Lord. You hem me in behind and before. You have laid Your hand upon me. For such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from Your Spirit? Where can I flee from Your presence? If I go up to the heavens, You are there. And if I make my bed in the depths, You are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there Your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast." And then these words from our Lord Jesus Christ that He shared with His disciples, knowing that His earthly journey was about to come to an end. And so He gave to them these words of hope and of promise. And He said to them, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in Me. For in My Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto Myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Yet a little while, and the world will see Me no more, but you see Me. Because I live, you shall live also. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you, but not as the world gives, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." And then finally, these words from Psalm 23, where we are simply reminded in these ancient and familiar words of God as our gentlest of all shepherds and our gracious host, where the psalmist wrote, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For Thou art with me. Thy rod and Thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And so we're reminded today that God remains and forever shall be Michael's gentlest of all shepherds and the most gracious of all hosts to him. We're pleased at this time to have his cousin Justin come and share a song that very familiar to not only Justin, but to Michael as well.
Thank you for having me do this. Appreciate it. I'm honored. This is for Mike. Thank you.
sit beside me, my only son. Yeah, listen closely to what I say. And if you do this, it'll help you some sunny day. Oh, yeah. Forgets lust, rich man's gold. All that's need, my soul, is in your soul. Yeah, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna get to try. All that I want for you, my son, feel satisfied. Be a simple kind of man. Yeah, be someone you love and understand. Baby, be a simple kind of man. Yeah, you can do this on my side. I know. Son, don't you worry, you'll find yourself. Follow your heart, nothing else. Oh, yeah. And you can do this if you try. All that I want for you, my son, so feel satisfied. Be a simple kind of man. Yeah, you can do this. Oh, my son, I know you can. Baby, be a simple kind of man. Oh, you can do this. 'Cause I know. Yeah, be someone you love and understand. Baby, be a simple kind of man. Yeah, you can do this. I know.
Justin, thank you.
Yes, sir.
At this time, we're privileged to have Gigi, Michael's sister, come and share reflections on behalf of herself and the family.
What we once enjoyed and deeply loved, we can never lose. For all that we love, deeply becomes a part of us. Helen Keller. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Jennifer Grosso, or Gigi to most. John Michael Grosso, or as I called him most of the time, Wags, was born on the 26th of May, 1986. Later that summer, Mom, Dad, and I were visiting Roanoke. I was 5. And my Aunt Lonnie mentioned that she had heard someone having trouble placing a medical needs child up for adoption. My parents just knew immediately. Discussions, legal procedures followed, and he joined our family very soon after that. I had finally gotten the baby brother that I so wanted. He was named John after his maternal grandfather, a name that has been passed down and that his uncle has also. He was named Michael after his paternal grandfather. He mainly went by Mike or Michael to his friends or family. The nurses who cared for him before he joined our family also called him Michael. They didn't know that my parents had already picked out this name. I can remember the first time I held him. It was like holding a doll. It was basically just swaddling and a little face, but he smiled. He just smiled a lot. As a baby, he was just the definition of joy. I don't ever remember him crying or being fussy. Everything was a game, and he was just simply delighted to be a part of it all. He used to, one day we brought the car seat in for some reason, and he locked himself in the car seat and just waited to be let out. And we joked and laughed, and can't you get out yourself? And, oh, you can't get out yourself. And so once we finally let him out, he just clicked it right back together again and just waited. He didn't panic. He didn't want out immediately. He was just waiting. Everything was just fun. As he grew up, he couldn't say Michael. So instead, he called himself Waggles. And that's where I got Wags from, and it stuck. At 18 months old, he was diagnosed with leukemia. We happened to live an hour from Melbourne Children's Hospital in Australia, which was the best in the world at the time. Wags was a fighter, and he kicked cancer's butt. Unfortunately, you don't go through those kinds of therapies without affecting your development and life. Nonetheless, through it all, he was a ray of sunshine for everyone that came across him. The doctors, the nurses, the staff at the hospital, other patients, all adored him. I'll never forget how many times I heard so many different people tell my parents in awe how strong and brave he was, and how infectious and unquenchable his happy nature was. I remember visiting him at the hospital, and even though he was connected to wires and drips, and he did not feel good, he would see us, and he would bounce, and he would clap. He was just so happy. Sorry. In 88, a few months after Michael's diagnosis, David joined our family, and we were complete. We grew up mainly in Rome, with a couple years in the States mixed in, and a few months of them here in Roanoke, where we actually got to spend time with our family and get to know them better since we lived overseas most of the time. On the weekends, we did a lot of activities together in Rome, family trips, exploring places that we were lucky enough to live in. We hated it, but we look back now and thanks. We cheered each other on with sports and plays and any kind of event, we were always there for each other. We spent a lot of time in Rome traffic in general, and one of these days, it could have been a Tuesday, Michael had a need to use the restroom, and we could not pull over. If you know Rome traffic, I mean, there is no way that you can just pull over. So Michael crept into the back with a little bottle, and he relieved himself in that bottle. And we have a picture, but that's staying secret. A sibling is an extension of who we are. We grow up having the same experiences and memories, and laughs and cries. We get each other's humor and have jokes that only we understand that run for our whole lives. When he was a kid, he would tell this joke. I can't tell it right now, but it was a good kid's joke the first time you heard it, if it was told right. He just could not tell it right to save his soul. But he told it so many times, and he developed his own way of telling it. We laughed just because of his way of telling it. In 91, we moved to Rome and went to the same school because international schools tend to all be together and not separate establishments like they are here in the States. We would get off the bus, he would start crying and not want to go in his line or leave me. I would walk him up the 3 flights of stairs to his classroom every day for the first few weeks, and just occasionally afterwards. He was born with hemifacial microsomnia and did not have an ear on his right side or hearing. Over the course of many years, he made the decision, the heroic decision, to undergo a multitude of surgeries. The end result was one of the most successful and natural-looking ears ever made. His strength to go through this process was something I always drew strength from myself and will continue to do so. Mike was a fierce friend. Many of the friends in his life have since spread across the world, but still keep in touch no matter how many miles there are between them. Marco and James, his partners in mischief, were very close with Mike. They basically grew up together and brought a lot of love and grief. I know they both wish they could be here today, and they want everyone to know that. Wags didn't know any strangers. He treated everyone like a best friend. If my brother ever helped you, would you raise your hand? If my brother ever complimented you, would you raise your hand? If my brother ever offered you the shirt off his back, something to eat, anything you needed or wanted, would you please raise your hand? If you didn't raise your hand to any of these, then you never had the privilege of knowing my brother. I guarantee you, within your first conversation, he would have given you a compliment, he would have helped you, or he would have offered you the shirt off his back, something to eat, anything you could have possibly needed or wanted. We used to attend Rome Baptist Church, and we became quite close with most of the congregation. This is one of my favorite stories. One of the families had recently moved from Africa, and they had a toddler named Faith who had sickle cell anemia. They also happened to have 2 newborn infant twins named Hope and Love. I get rides from my mom every once in a while, but they were having a really rough time, and Michael and I would go out and help them. When we took the public transportation, it took us between 2 and 3 hours to go from the north of Rome to the south of Rome, and neither one of us ever complained. That's just how he was. He just wanted to help. He needed to help. While we were cleaning out his apartment, too many times I thought I should call him because he would just love to help. He once helped me move a friend that he didn't even know. I said, would you be able to do it? And he said, just tell me when. Like, duh, I would do that. The last time I saw my brother, he was helping me. We were getting my car in the shop. I don't speak car, and he does. And he was able to translate for me, and he did that a lot. After that, we went grocery shopping. He didn't just help me carry the bags to the door, but all the way inside and put them on tables and counters so I could reach them. He offered to help me put them away just like he normally would, but Dad was waiting, and I told him that I could do it. He was so protective. He looked out for me and everyone like a wanted so much more for me than I ever wanted for myself, and he tried to give it to me. Mike's world and life were forever changed when his first daughter, Elena, was born. And then again, when his second daughter, Rosie, came along. To say he loved his daughters is like saying fire is warm and ice is cool. All fathers love their daughters. But this is when Wags found his true calling and purpose in life. He was the kind of dad who would go to the park and actually play and organize games with all the kids. Just all the kids there. He just had such a great time, and he wanted Elena to have the best possible time that she could. He loved cuddling and watching movies with his kids. He loved Dad dancing and would do absolutely anything to make them smile or laugh, including but not limited to many discussions involving poop or potty related issues and very bad dad jokes. Elena and Rosie were the light of his life, and he was never more carefree, joyful, serene, or motivated than when he was with them. As protective as he has been of his girls in life, so will he continue to be so. I know he will watch over them and continue to be proud of every milestone and accomplishment that they have. Death ends not a relation, not a life, but a relationship. It ends a life, but not a relationship. My relationship with Wags will continue until my last breath. I will take the lessons I learned with him and from him forever. I will celebrate his birthday. I'll take better care of my teeth. Some of you may not know this, but he was a stickler for oral hygiene, and I will respect that and make that part of my life now. I will talk to him because I know that he hears me, and that brings me comfort. As long as we keep loving him, his love will live on. Thank you all for being here today to celebrate and remember Mike, the son, the brother, the father, the nephew, the cousin, the friend, the person who loved Bob Marley, John Lennon, Pink Floyd, America, ribs, prosciutto crudo, chocolate chip cookies, the Italian soccer team. What am I missing? Anyone else? Can anyone else think of what he loved? Goliador. I think Goliador is going to go out of business now. So we've all received and could not appreciate more many condolences from people who knew and loved him or knew that we loved him. A dear friend of mine wrote me a message that I would like to share with y'all. She said, please reach out to us if you need anything. It's okay to break down. It's okay to ask for help. It's okay to not be okay. But it is not okay to struggle alone. The one I'm focusing on here today, a lot of these hit me. This hit me for a lot of reasons. Is I want you all to know that you are not alone, ever. In Macbeth, William Shakespeare wrote, "Give sorrow words. The grief that does not speak knits up overwrought hearts and bids it break. You are not alone in suffering. You are not alone in struggling. You are not alone in muddling through this precious gift we call life. Things sound different in your head. Please reach out. Please talk to someone. Please ask someone for help. Please remember my brother and pay it forward like he did." I would like to end with his favorite quote. "God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference." Wags, you are special and more loved than you ever knew.
Gigi, thank you so much. As your family has whispered to you, that was absolutely beautiful. I cannot think of anything that could have been done better. And I know it was difficult for you, but what a wonderful tribute to Wags. The family, while we're gathered here, did want to extend an opportunity for any of you who might have a brief thought or reflection about Michael that you would like to share during our gathering. You do not have to come up here. We can be very relaxed and informal, and if there's something that you'd like to share with the family and with us, you can simply do so right where you're seated. But again, we want to extend the opportunity for any folks who may wish to do that. Yes, absolutely.
I would like to face
everybody. Sure, absolutely.
Can everyone hear me?
Yeah.
For those who do not know me yet, I'm Bobby. David's close friend. We've known each other for close to 14 years now, and this will be one tough act to follow in Jiu-Jitsu. And I wanted to thank you guys too for giving me the opportunity to pay my most resented and heartfelt respects to Michael, or as I would call him, Jean-Michel. And you would call me Bublé, by the way. I mean, as long as I'm in Roanoke, that's all I hear, Bublé, 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 because I haven't spent one day in Roanoke other than this past week without Michael. And the Grosso family have been extremely, I don't even have the words to express how grateful I am for all they've done for me the past couple of years. And an instant bond was created between Gigi and I, Michael and I, Helena, parents, Carolyn, Ron. No need for me. David knows. And I will do everything that I can to, in my power to
sir. Absolutely. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
My name is John. This is my wife, Martha. We had the pleasure of living in Rome, and some of the first people that we met when we went there at the Rome Baptist Church was the Grossos. Of course, we were had been stuck in a hotel waiting for housing. Finding apartments in Rome was pretty challenging. We were there in the summertime of 1999, and so.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, I'm his cousin Whitney, and he lived with me at a point in his life. Me and Michael were pretty close. I'm close to Gigi. I'm close to David. I'm close to Carolyn and Ron. And everything Gigi said is true. Michael, this is my fault. And my kids were much younger then, but Michael, if I was taking him to the park, he wanted to go with me. And if they had soccer practice, he wanted to go watch. If I was cooking in the kitchen cooking dinner, he was usually probably sitting in my kitchen bothering me. But there, trying to be a part of whatever it was I was doing. He wanted to be the good cousin, the big uncle, the guy helping me around the house, and I'm just gonna really miss Michael. Life's been a little crazier for these last few years, so we've all kind of not got to spend that same time that we used to spend together. And I wasn't ready for this. I kind of thought we had another 30 to talk about all the bad things we did the 30 before. So I'm gonna miss. I know we all know, but I do believe what Gigi said. Let's celebrate him. Let's remember what he gave us. Let's remember that spirit, because another thing Gigi said that really resonated with me is that Michael beamed happiness. If it was raining outside, he would see sunshine. He just really found the positives. When things could be dark, Michael looked for brightness. So I think we need to celebrate who he was and continue that. And let's not, we won't forget him. There's no way. And I love you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Well, for those of you that shared, thank you so much. And I know that folks have shared with you privately in the visitation and probably following the service their stories and memories as well. And Gigi, thank you so much. Beautiful.
To you as we close the service, the word of faith contained in Paul's letter to the Christians at Rome, where he wrote, "Who shall separate us from the love of God? Tribulation, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, peril, or sword?" Paul said, "No. That in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor anything in all of creation can separate us from the love." So we conclude this service in the knowledge and the confidence and the hope that absolutely nothing has separated Michael Wags from the love of God. At this time we say, earth to earth, dust to dust, and ashes to ashes, as old as mortal. Committed here to the earth, but it has done so in the knowledge that his spirit is going to be with his creator and his redeemer. And so we are sustained by a faith that is stronger than death. And we are comforted by the hope of the resurrection that is to come. And just as John Michael Wags Grosso bore the image of the earthly for 35 years, so shall he now bear the image of the heavenly for all eternity.
unto him and give him peace. Give him peace now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Close in prayer, and I want to invite you to stand as the family is dismissed following the benediction. Gracious God, again we just come into your presence. And Lord, we lift up Michael's family to you and ask that you would just surround them with love and grace coming from you. Use family and friends to be instruments of that to their hearts and their spirits. We thank you for Michael. Commend him into your eternal care. In Christ's name we pray.